Leadership Forum. So we host events almost every week focused on data and entrepreneurship. This is an event. We've had about 170 events. Over 9,000 people we have physically touched, like today, and 270 speakers. So if you go to our web page or go to our meetup page, you'll see some of the other events coming up. So we have on November 30th an event on AI-driven automation in customer service and customer support, with speakers from the CTO of ServiceNow and other speakers from Zendesk, Wipro, and the Hive's company, Neva. And on December 14th, we have a faculty member from Carnegie Mellon, and so we have a close relationship with CMU, and so he's going to be speaking about genomics and the use of machine learning. Many of you who are new here don't know the Hive. So the Hive is an early stage funding entity with a focus on AI and data across enterprise, IoT, and online segments. And so everything we do has a touch point with AI and data. Be a part of the conversation today. Use the hashtag HiveData. The way we'll do the event is that I'm going to have my colleague introduce the speaker, and after the talk by the speaker, we'll have a fireside chat, and it'll be led by MR Rangaswami. And so with that, I'd like to introduce, first let me introduce the host of tonight's event, Ram Jambunathan. Ram is the head of SAP.io, which is an innovation entity within SAP. Ram.
Hi, thank you, and it's a pleasure to have you all attend such a prestigious event this evening. As Ravi mentioned, my name is Ram Jambunathan. I'm managing director of a function called SAP.io here at SAP. As you may know, SAP strategy is to become the cloud company powered by SAP HANA. And through that, we want to drive the digital transformation agenda of our customers and of businesses worldwide. And the reason we do that is because we believe the most valuable asset that a company has is that asset that's not found on its balance sheet, and that's its data. And to be able to drive that agenda requires SAP to remain at the forefront of innovation. And that innovation happens at all stages, but increasingly we see breakthrough innovation happening at the earliest stage, at the stage of incubation. And because of that, SAP has instituted a new business function called SAP.io, focused on helping grow the next big business for SAP and jump-starting an ecosystem of innovation for SAP. And when we engage with the ecosystem now, we do that in three ways. First, we do that through direct investment into seed and early stage startups. Secondly, we're building a network of accelerators and incubators globally. And thirdly, we want to help drive outreach and education of what's happening in innovation globally in areas relevant to SAP. And with along those themes, it makes sense to sponsor and host initiatives such as what we're doing tonight with the Hive. We share this common goal of really understanding how data can drive unlock value and drive transformation across industries globally. So again, thank you for being able to attend tonight. If you have any questions, if you're an entrepreneur, or if you're a venture capitalist, or if you're just interested in learning more about SAP.io, please come see me after the talk. But again, a great honor and a pleasure to have you here with us this evening. Thank you.
Thank you. I can't think of a better person to introduce our speaker today than Ram Reddy. Ram is a prolific angel investor. He's invested in an LP in a number of different funds, including the Hive, and is a close friend. He's a founder of a very successful analyst firm in India, and a big kind of champion of various charities. He's also the president-elect of Thai, Ram Reddy.
Thanks, Ravi. Welcome, everybody. Ravi, you bring the best speakers to Hive, and I thought each time I come, you know, it's even better. You know, this race is very special. So if anybody who's involved in the startup ecosystem of India hasn't heard of Mohandas Pai, probably you don't belong in this planet. So I had the pleasure of actually hearing Mr. Pai speak at the Hyderabad launch of its IT policy earlier this year. And he spoke for 3 minutes, but probably got the best ovation of the entire audience, even inclusive of several other marquee iconic speakers that were there, including the Chief Minister and the IT Minister. So I want to just kind of narrate a few things about Mr. Pai and his track record. Of course, many of you know him. Recipient of many awards, multiple awards, Padma Shri, one of them. Of course, the ultimate coveted award, India, for civil recognition. He serves as a chair for the Manipal Global Education, and also heads a private equity fund called Aaron Capital. Of course, his name to fame is his service for 20 years as the CFO of Infosys. He, I would say, responsible for one of the few, but primarily responsible for scaling a $5 million company to a $6.5 billion enterprise, global enterprise. So he's done many, many things. On the philanthropy side, everybody knows about Akshaya Patra. I've been a supporter of Akshaya Patra for many years, but he's a co-founder and has done amazing things with it. So he's an innovator. He thinks outside the box, and this was amazing. Probably the world's largest mid-day program that exists right now and growing. So he, you know, of course, from a professional side, being in the financial sector, he has been a part of governance and has led or served on the boards or trusteeship for many recognizable organizations. He was part of the, I'm not sure if he's still on the SEBI board.
I finished.
He served his term there. And of course, he's a trustee on the International Financial Reporting Standards. I don't even know what that is, to be honest, but it sounds very, you know, important. So now he's serving on the National Stock Exchange India. So of course, on the VC and the startup world funding side, which got all of us excited, and many of us were in Delhi, you know, last year with Frank, who led our, you know, delegation. So he is very, very well recognized. He is a partner in, I think he's responsible for funding 14 VCs and partner in many more. He has himself funded 120 startups or more. So this is actually part of Google. My exercise this afternoon was to go on Google and see what else don't I know about this man, you know? And I saw that, you know, there were like so much. I said, okay, I'm not gonna do a crash course on that, at least from whatever I know, I just wrote down. But there's many, many accomplishments that Mr. Pai is recognized for. So, but one thing I'd say, he's probably the single strongest proponent for the startup ecosystem in India. So if I say that, you know, from hearing him for 3 minutes the last time. So, you know, without much ado, I don't wanna be in between you and him. Love for you to hear from him yourself, and it's my distinct honor and pleasure to invite Mr. Mohandas Pai to come and spend a few minutes with us. Ravi.
I start here? Okay. Yeah. There's a lot of numbers in my slides, so I'll stay here instead of walking around. First of all, Ravi, Ram, thank you very much for being very kind to me. You called the unknown person from the deep south of India, usually forgotten, to come to the valley and talk to all of you. I'm very grateful.
Deep South is good.
I come from a very remote place called Bangalore. When Ravi met me, he said, why don't you come and speak? You know, he said, what are you going to speak on? Since Hive is all about data, big data, analytics, entrepreneurship, I said, let me talk about India, which I know, at 2030. A long enough time to make sure that whatever I say, you're not going to hold me to it, because I might not be around, and you might forget. And about tech entrepreneurship, which I know very well, reasonably well, and about a figure for India, which is very aspirational, which all of us can work together to make it happen, a $10 trillion economy, because India is 17% of humanity. If China and India, which are 40% of humanity, do very well, we'll have a very different planet. And also, to all of you in the Valley, you have a vested interest in India and China, because if 40% of the world consume energy the way you do, there's not going to be enough for all of you. And the waters are going to rise 100 feet, that's what people tell us, right? We've seen all those maps. So I said we'll talk about this. Now, India will be the third largest economy in the world in nominal terms by 2030. It's already the third largest economy in PPP terms today. It's a very large economy. Per capita income is very less because, you know, you've got a lot of people in that part of the world. But nevertheless, in nominal terms too, will be the third largest. And if you look at the next 15 years, a large part of global growth is coming from India. Here's some data for you. Let's start with data. Population today is 1.29 billion. We're only growing at 1.3% a year. You grow at 1.1%, that's replacement rate. The replacement rate is defined as 2.1 TFR, that is total fertility rate, children born to women in the fertile period. India is today at about 2.3, but we only have 935 women per 1,000 men. If you apply 2.3 to women as a percent of the population, we're already below replacement rate. And China is also way below replacement rate. So for the next many years, India's population will grow essentially because people are living longer. And the number of children born is going to be stagnant for the next 15 years. It's a good time to be, but it's also very challenging because what you're doing here is directly going to impact India. You're involved in automation, in AI, ML, all the nice stuff that are going to destroy a lot of jobs. And you know, the challenge is going to be faced in India. And China is past that period because China's working age population of 850 million is tapering down. So China could go older before it grows, before it goes richer, but the per capita income is $8,500. Our life expectancy is only 68 years on an average today. If you take away infant mortality, which is about 45 per 1,000 per year, we'll be something like about 71. The world over, I think, life expectancy is 73 years. In Japan, women live up to 88 and men up to 85. That's a country which has got the longest lifespan. And I think at the time of 1900, India's life expectancy was 21 years. In 1947, when we got freedom, it was about 27 years. So we moved a long way, but we still have to move a long way. Literacy is 74% today, but for children in the age group, for people in the age group of 15 to 64, it's about 91-92%, which is not bad, but not good either. GDP this year will be $2.25 trillion in nominal terms. Nominal terms is how you count, and we could have been $3 trillion, except the rupee depreciated from 45 to 67, and right now is about 68 or so. We're growing at 7.6%, that's pretty good, right? And we could grow this year at 8% because we had a good monsoon, and 52% of India's population depends on agriculture. So a good monsoon means that the bottom of the pyramid will see good growth. Our GDP in PPP terms, purchasing power parity terms, is $8 trillion. We're the third largest in the world. Third largest economy in the world in PPP terms. PPP means you take a basket of goods and services, value that by currency, do the same elsewhere, and if you equate that, that gives you PPP. The PPP multiple for India is something like 3 or 3.2. So because we are an undervalued currency. And if you take China, China's GDP is about $10 trillion, $11 trillion. The PPP is 18.5. The United States economy is about 17.8. So China is the largest economy in the world in PPP terms too. And India is a very large economy, and we should not forget this. Per capita income is $1,615. That's probably, you know, 2 days' income for all of you. It's pretty less. Export-import also is less. But government of India has not borrowed money. So we are safe. Whatever happens in the world, we'll still be safe. We can go back to the bullock cart and do whatever we do, even if the energy crisis goes up in somewhat. But we have a small amount of debt in terms of dollars for the whole of India. But we have a challenge. Our interest to gross revenue, total revenue in India for government is 18% of GDP. United States is 25%. Brazil is 30%. But we have 25% of our annual revenues for the federal government going to pay interest. So our rating doesn't go up because this figure is fairly high. And debt to GDP is decent. United States is about 105. Japan is 250. China is about 250% of GDP. Now, this is an interesting slide. How have we done in the last 25 years? If you're in India, we have a large leftist media, or media is left. They always talk about the wrong things of India, but the poverty in India. And if you come to India and have any social theory, you can find the data to fit the theory. So you can think anything you want of India, good or bad, and you can get data to prove that you're right. Everything is right about India, everything is wrong about India, but India continues the way it is on a whole stream, in whatever directions it thinks fit, which nobody knows. So, for the last 25 years, we got freedom in 1947. In 1950, we passed the Industrial Policy Resolution, where we tried to create a state-dominated economy. Because when India got freedom, our leaders were educated in Cambridge, the Fabian School of Economics. And being educated there, they thought the Soviet model was very good. They wanted this public sector to be dominant. And the kind of economic condition, we led to what is called the Hindu rate of growth, 3.5% a year. So we grew at 3.5% a year from 1950 till 1980, and the population grew at 2.1%. So per capita income didn't grow. We remained in poverty for a long period of time. In the late 18th century, 1745, China-India made up 45% of world GDP. And because Great Britain discovered or created the steam engine and automation started, the Industrial Revolution started, China's in India share has come down to what it is. India's share in global GDP today should be something like about 2.53%, and China's share is about 12.5%, that's about 15%. In PPP is about nearly 30%, and if you look forward, they're going to come to 45% by 2030. I got a slide to show that. So we're going to see the last 250, 300 years is a blimp in the long civilization history. From the start of the Christian era till the 18th century, India and China dominated the world. Then came Great Britain and Europe, which dominated the world for about 200 years. And after the war, of course, the biggest, greatest country in the world, the country where everybody wants to come to, and the state where everybody wants to come to, the United States dominates. So if you look at our population growth, 1.5% a year for 25 years, GDP has grown at 13.8% a year, CAGR for 25 years in rupees. And we have grown 8.4% a year in dollars for 25 years continuously, 8.4%. China grew 9.9% from 1978 till 2015. And we grew at 8.4% when we opened the economy from 1991 till 2016. 8.4% is nothing to sneer at. It's a very good rate. The base was low, but you grew, and that's fantastic. Per capita income has grown at 6.8%. Not bad. Per capita income going there. Export imports has grown. Share in world trade, we are now 5.9% including services. In 1900, we had 10% of world trade. In 1947, it came down to 2% of world trade. Now we are at 6%. And if you look at the savings rate, 33% of GDP is pretty good. Investment is 34.5%. China, in terms of savings, is 45%. Investment, I think, is 50%. You know, China is a different class by itself. And you know, what China has done, I don't think any country can ever do, ever in human history. And now China is plateauing off. There's no more large country left in the world. There are only two of them with a billion population. You've seen one grow so fast, and the other one is grow. And that's why the environment and sustainability has become very, very important. Look at this growth rate. We've grown at 9.6%, 8.9%. We came down in 2013 in the aftermath of the global financial crisis. We've gone back to 7.6%. This year, 7.5% is expected. Maybe we'll reach 8%. So we've been growing consistently. We came down once, but apart from that, there's been fairly consistent growth. So this is not a flash in the pan, but I think it's very continuous. This is an interesting slide. India is about 10, 12 years behind China. China opened up in 1978, and in 1978, I think India's GDP was $150 billion, China was around $140 billion. It's similar. Right? China was much bigger, but then China took off because it opened up. We opened up in 1991, and we are 10 years behind China. So China has done a tremendous work, and you can see the Chinese figures here. The reason why China grew at 9.9, India grew at 8.4, in my opinion, is women's participation in the workforce. 80% of Chinese women participate in the workforce. India is only 30%. We seem to oppress a woman too much compared to what China did. When Mao took power in 1949, he said, he made a famous statement, women hold up half of heaven. So they brought in equality between the genders, and that really paid off in China. And women are very well educated, they participate. Whereas in India, we've done a very shoddy, bad job. And hopefully now, we're going to see a good progress. 40% of all engineering graduates in India are women. In medicine, 60% are women. And in medicine, in our colleges, I've been telling the chancellor, we need some reservation affirmative action for men. Because the women become 60% and men don't participate, you know, there's going to be an imbalance because we see that 30% of women doctors drop out within 10 years because, you know, they become mothers and the dropout is very high. So, you know, we need some kind of a balance. So I hope you will forgive me for this statement. Please look at this chart. This chart is an important chart. What is happening on the world? 2015, GDP of the world is $74 trillion. OECD is 40.8, 41, emerging markets 32.5. By 2021, the emerging markets are going to overtake the OECD. And this is because Europe is aging tremendously. Japan, Russia's population is declining, the European part. Scandinavia is declining, and Germany is getting very old. They're not producing enough babies, they're not having enough babies. And even Italy is not producing enough babies, they're all below replacement rate. In UK, in London, 25% of the population is Asian, and it may increase. We're seeing an increase in population of North Africans in Paris. So we're seeing all this kind of a demographic trend. The biggest change happening in the world is the environment and demographics, and that's impacting. So by 2021, the emerging markets become larger because we believe by 2031, the emerging markets could grow at about 6.2%. China could grow at 6%, 5-6%, still very large. And India could grow at 8.5-9%. With a little bit of currency appreciation, will be $10 trillion. And other parts of the world can grow at 6%. Sub-Saharan Africa has grown at 6% for the last 15 years. The large part of the world is growing because consumption patterns are there and the per capita income is quite low. So we're going to see a dramatic change in the composition of the world. The United States is 25% of world GDP and they'll come down to something like maybe about 15-18% by 2031. Of course, the United States will invest on the world and own the world because we own the technology that reshapes the world. But we are in the midst of the biggest economic transformation for the last 250 years. India-China. China's population growth rate is 0.48% a year, 5% in a decade. It's peak because of the one-child policy in 1978. And the one-child policy has made sure the birth rate has come down and created other kinds of issues. Literacy is 92%, $10.8 trillion, India is 2. And if you look at you know, PPP, China is about $18 trillion in GDP. Export, China is the factory of the world, largest exporter, largest importer, largest currency reserves, and gross debt to GDP too is very, very large. But this is a comparison between India and China to give hope that India could be 7-year China, but in a different model. China followed the manufacturing model. India is still confused whether to follow manufacturing or services. We don't know what's going to happen right now. Services are the largest component. It's more like the developed countries in terms of services composition. But this is a very interesting chart. We had high inflation in India in the last many years that led to the change of government. 12.5% inflation is a bit too much for any country. But now it's come down to 5%. You know, United States is struggling to improve inflation. I think it's 1-1.5%. Europe gets 2%, they're very happy. Japan is suffering from deflation for the last 20 years. They get 1% inflation, they're very happy. The target is 2% for the Bank of Japan. This is just a slide to show. The federal government used to spend 2.9% of GDP on subsidies. They cut down on subsidies because of technology. We transfer benefits directly to people because most people have bank accounts. And this gives hope that much part of the taxes will be spent for development. And I think what the federal government has done the last 3 years in terms of opening 250 million bank accounts. In just 12 months, they opened 250 million bank accounts. They created Aadhaar, which I'll talk about. The mobile is leading a revolution. So we hope the leakage will be reduced, and this will enable more money to come for development. India has a strong industrial base. We should never forget that. We make 90 million tons of steel. The United States makes 100. We're the third largest in terms of steel, fourth largest actually, but we'll overtake the United States this year. Of course, China makes 750 million. It's a, you know, China must exclude China in comparison, otherwise it gives you a complex. So, United States 100, Japan is 105, cement capacity 370 million, China is about 1.2 billion tons. We make many two-wheelers. We're not a car economy, two-wheelers, because people can't afford to buy. We have a capacity of 5.5 million cars. United States makes about 18, I'm sorry, the data is wrong. They make about 18 million vehicles per year. Japan makes 14.8, but they export a lot of it. We have a $160 billion IT industry. That's very, very large for a country like India. In terms of power, in terms of cell phones, it is a large manufacturing center, large economy, but internally focused. And the base has been built up over a period of time. This is an interesting slide. We have about people in the productive age group of 15 to 64, or something like about 65%. It's a very young country, average age of 27 years. And we are supposed to go through a process called a demographic dividend, because we have a young consuming class. But I'll explain to you what could happen. As you see, we have a 300 million middle class. Middle class for us is about $4,000 a year. With the PPP is about $14,000 a year. But for $4,000 a year, for a family of five, that is about $20,000, you can have a nice house, you can have a car, a decent job, you can go for a holiday to Bangkok. The flights are very cheap. US, you know, it takes about 5 years of savings and all that. So you'll have a little bit of savings, you can educate your children well. So for $20,000 for a family, you live very well in India. If the currency goes a long way, you can have two or three people working for you at home, so you don't have to wash your dishes and the clothes and all, which some of you might have to do even if you earn $500,000. But you know, we can live by. Look at this slide. This is the core. By 2020, the average age will be 29 years for India. Japan is 48. 25% of the Japanese population is past the age of 65. Last year, 1.25 million Japanese died. Only 1 million babies are born. 2 years ago, adult diapers sold more than baby diapers. Right? Japan's population is shrinking. It's actually shrinking. The population of 126 million is expected to be 97 million by 2050 and 67 million by 2100. So when you have a shrinking population and an aging population, you're going to be terribly in trouble. And if we want to see what population change can do to a country, we must go to Japan, to the rural area. It's a fantastic country, highly productive people, but just not enough babies. So you know, babies are very important for a society to live. Western Europe average age is 45 years. So they're going to face the problem of pension. How do you pay pension when there are two young people to support one senior person, because you pay pension on a pay-as-you-earn basis? You don't have a funded plan. You've got to pay as you earn. You know, somebody told me yesterday that in the United States, your liabilities for pension and Medicare, if you capitalize, is $75 trillion. Because you know, it is on a cash basis, you don't have a fund given to all of you to earn 15-16% IRR, because you know, they only pay by taxes. So even China is 37 years by 2020, and this is a very, very significant thing. In terms of education, we have 800 universities, 51,000 colleges, 35 million young people in college. I think United States has about 20, China has about 36, 37. China only has 16 million babies a year. We make about 25 million babies a year. 1 million babies die by the age of 5, the big tragedy. And 24 attain the age of majority every single year. Our gross enrollment rate of children in the young people, the age group of 18 to 23 going to college is 25. America should be 75, 80. And even in India, if you look at the whole of India, and you must look at India as a collection of countries. India is not one single country. I was telling one of my friends that people in the Punjab have got nothing to do with people in Tamil Nadu. They look very different, they eat very differently, they dress very different, you know, they dance very differently, they sing very differently. You all know that, right? But we're all one single country because we're united by a civilization force for a very long period of time. Tamil Nadu has got a gross enrollment rate of 45. 45% of people in the age group 18-23 go to college. West Bengal in the east has got a gross enrollment rate of something like about 19. The TFR, total fertility rate in the whole of South India, is about 1.7, below replacement rate. West Bengal is about 1.6. My friend Sanjeev Sanyal, who is an author and a great analyst, he said that the Bhadralok in West Bengal, Bhadralok is the educated middle class, they're going to disappear by 2030. Because one, they're migrating, and two, the population is coming down, and they're still not gone through the debate of why the British left India in 1947. Some of you might understand what an Atta means, right? The debate is still going on. Now, they think very long term. It's like Mao Tse-Sung was asked, what do you think is the impact of the French Revolution? And he looked around and told the observer, you know, it's too early to determine. So in the East, people have a longer time span because they think they're going to be born again and again and again. But we got 6 million young people in engineering. 6 million in engineering. 6 million engineering is not bad. And 6 million means we graduate 1 to 1.2 million every year. Right now it's 800,000 because, you know, they joined 5 years back. Out of it, 200,000 are very good engineers. 200,000 can be trained, and the balance have got Ola and Uber cars to drive. Some of them have thought how clean the bonnet and look at the engine and the nice truck. You know, there's still some Ola and Uber are great benefits to us. We got 1.7 million people in as nurses and doctors. We produce 55,000 doctors a year. About 10-15 come away to the United States or Western Europe or wherever it is. And in law, we are very lucky, only 700,000 lawyers. So, you know, they can't destroy the country as yet, right? You know what lawyers do. So we got a larger, let's say, educational infrastructure. Investment as GDP has come down from 38%, 32%. This data is old, 2013-14, but now it's come down, it's stabilizing at 32, 33. We got enough savings. We only depend on overseas capital for 2% of GDP. 2% of GDP is quite okay, and this 2% of GDP comes from software export, which is $75 billion, and it comes from remittances, another $77 billion. Remittances is just soft right now because of the oil crisis, but whatever it is, it's a well-structured economy. We are a consumption-led economy. 70% of GDP is consumption, 30% is investment. If you look at China, 40% or 35% is consumption, and about 40% investment and 30% and 20% is exports. So China is very dependent, and that's been the rule for success because they became the factory of the world. But India is driven by internal consumption, and that is slightly more sustainable. This is an interesting slide, all right? You know, when you compare India and all global things, they compare Finland and Singapore with India. Singapore is half the size of Bangalore. You know, Mahatma Gandhi once said that if all the Indians spit, Great Britain will be drowned. I don't want to say what else they can do, but you know, Singapore is a very small place. So in anything, digital penetration, growth and all that, you can't compare a Finland and a Singapore, right? I mean, there are only two countries with a billion population. Not in the United States. You know, largest country, China, India, and then the number three is United States. United States, 320 million. 320 million is just larger than the largest state in India, Uttar Pradesh. You've got 200 million people. 200 million people in the state, you know, it's chaos. So, but if you look here, industry is where China has done well. China's got 40% of its people depend on industry. India's got only 29% of people depend on industry. You know, in agriculture, 52% of India is depend on agriculture, which is now, right, this year, this is 2 years data, is 16% of GDP. Our problem is 52% of people depend on 16% of GDP growing at 3%. So 48% of people depend on industry and services, which are growing at 10%, because the growth rate is 8%. So the disparity between people on the land and people off the land is widening, and that is creating social tension. And in India, sadly, 76%, 74% of the votes are in the rural areas. So India today, very different thing. In 1978, Parliament passed a law to say that the seats in Parliament will be frozen at the 1971 population levels. Because in the Constitution we said every 10 years, you have to have a delimitation and readjust the seats based upon population growth. And suddenly they found the South is not growing, Middle India is growing very fast, and people protested and said, we're going to become smaller. You know, gerrymandering in the United States and all the nice stuff where they adjust everything every 5 years. Okay, we used to do it once in 10 years. Then Parliament passed a law freezing it for 30 years. And it meant the power grid in the urban areas and rural areas was frozen from 1971 till 2001. In 2004, the government set up a panel which came with the recommendation 2008 to say that they're going to take the 2001 census level to fix these areas. But by the time it was all done, they took the 2011 census figures, thank God. Based upon the 2011 census, 2001 census, we have about 26% for the urban areas and 74% for the rural areas, whereas today people in urban areas are 40%. So 75% of revenues come from 26% of people, but political power is exactly the opposite. Political power is with the rural area who make up 74% of population. So cities generate wealth, but they don't have political power. And it's frozen till 2030. By 2030, urban India could be 50%. The world is 52% urban, China passed 50% urban just about 2 years ago. So this political power shifting is deepened democracy, but is creating imbalances because we are not investing in cities. So when you come to our cities, the infrastructure is bad, they're not badly maintained, because the resources go to give subsidies and other things. They also deserve a good bit, but investment is not happening. It's going to muddle to this political, political chain, and that's till 2030. Out of that, we don't know what is going to happen, and this is getting a great amount of tension. And you can see where China's policies, India's policies here. India's services a larger part of GDP than China, but industry. So we got to tackle this. We have to move 300 million people off the land into industry and services in the next 15 years. And that's going to be the major challenge. China spends 8.5% of GDP on infrastructure. They need 6.5. India needs 6.9 or 6.5. We spent 4.7. We are underinvested in infrastructure. China's overinvested. China's built all these ghost cities and all that very nicely where there are no people, but we got a lot of people but no cities. So, we are underinvested. We need a lot more capital, and many of you to come to India and help us hopefully set it up. Not a virtual country on the web, but a real country on the ground. But there's another slide about infrastructure. Now, this is about India. We got a good idea of what India is at this point of time. How is tech entrepreneurship going to reshape India? What are the challenges that India faces? India's challenge is low productivity of people. So you have to increase the productivity of people and reduce waste. To give you an example, our supply chain costs are 14% of GDP. So if you manufacture in Nagpur and want to sell to the coast in Mumbai, it's very expensive, so you can import from Shanghai right to Mumbai and make it competitive. Even though manufacturing costs in Nagpur and Shanghai could be the same. China's supply chain costs are 6% of GDP, United States is 5%. A truck goes 650 kilometers a day in the United States, our trucks go only 250 kilometers a day. So we have to become efficient, we have to improve productivity of labor. Our capital productivity is pretty good. 3 years back, we are earning mean returns of 21%. On equity, the United States I think earns 14-15%. They're very profitable because of lack of competition. So as far as capital productivity is concerned, they're not bad, but on labor productivity, we're very weak. And we have to make sure that increase, and that's where tech and tech entrepreneurs will come. Tech entrepreneurs will make India productive, solve India's problem. People like us who build IT service companies solve the United States problem, Euro's problem, because we made all these companies money efficient. We took legacy code and made it into good stuff and all the nice stuff, you know that. But we didn't solve India's problems. But these people are going to solve India's problems. We have 20,000 startups in India. They create $80 billion of value. We're third largest startup system in the world. And it's taking off in a very big way. And these are all young people who are dreaming of changing the world, like all of you dream about morning to evening. Except that you make $1 billion a year and they probably get about $5,000. Third largest system, we raise about $10 billion of funding a year. Only 5% is Indian. That's a tragedy. I'm going to answer something later, but only 5% of this capital for startups come from India, whereas in China, 65% of the capital for startups come from the Chinese. And much of it is concentrated in four or five areas. In 10 years, we'll have 100,000 startups in India. We estimate they'll employ 3.5 million people. It's going to be a major employment generator. We'll get $500 billion to $1 trillion of value, and we'll be the number two after the United States. We can't beat the United States, not in this century, in our lifetime. But we're going to be right behind the United States. And we're going to be joined at the hip. So Bangalore, California is going to become that beautiful corridor. We only require a direct flight now. We have to go via Delhi, and that brings us down. But hopefully we'll have a flight with all that new engines that you're developing in this part of the world. 30 million SMEs could be better. But we have a large IT industry, $175 billion this year, $110 billion of exports, and this $175 billion has a street value of $300 billion. If you look at the top 10 IT service companies, five are Indian. Look at the top five, three are Indian. And if you look at the total employees, the top 10 IT service companies, the 2 million people, 1.5 million are offshore in India. And out of this 4.5 million people in IT in India, 2 million work for American companies. The 6 million software people or IT people in America, 1 million are Indian, 2 million work for them in India, so out of 8 million, 3 million are Indians. So India and the United States are joined at the hip. So, we got to give these facts to President Trump and tell him to be slightly kinder so that we could work together and develop the United States and India together. So number of startups, Bangalore has become the ecosystem. Bangalore has 25,000 IT companies, about 7,000, 8,000 startups, and I think Bangalore has 35%, and we can see them all over. Bangalore, Delhi, Mumbai, Chennai. We also have startups in a place called Patna in Bihar. You heard of Patna in Bihar? There are many startups coming there. It's very good. We have startups in Jaipur. We got them all over. So young people are coming. If you get 100,000 startups, three founders per startup, 300,000 people, we're going to have 300,000 problem solvers who are going to be morning tuning, solving India's challenges. We got a million problems. We need a million problem solvers. That's the challenge India has. So I think we change the culture and the mindset to be innovative. Distribution by startup, we are all across the place, consumer web, mobile, education, e-commerce, enterprise, it's very well distributed. Now we're getting funds in AI and ML, companies coming up in all frontier areas. We are 5 years behind the United States in technology absorption in terms of sophistication. So if you look at the technology pyramid here, if you look at the bottom 40%, India could be 60% of what? 60% of the total United States and India. Look at the middle, it could be maybe 30%. If you look at the top 25%, it could be 15%. Right? Because innovation happens here. You've got capital, risk takers, mentors, all nice systems. A $1 billion valuation, is important, but they're coming up. We've got, I think, it's eight unicorns, right? America's got 100 to 1, nobody counts, but Flipkart, others, they're all in e-commerce. Paytm has done very well, that's a mobile wallet. Suddenly the valuation doubled in just a day because Prime Minister Modi said 85% of currency in India is no longer legal tender. 86%. It's fantastic, right? Because people didn't know what to spend because no longer legal tender, right? Even in America too, you've got a lot of your currency outside the United States. Nobody knows where they are and what they are. Top 100 companies, startups across, and you can see all of them in consumer, e-commerce, etc. These are all data. We've got some exits, nice exits. Some of them are very spectacular, but not as much as here because you're not coming to India for long enough time to buy all those companies and give us those beautiful dollars. So they tend to grow dramatically because if you look at the NASDAQ, 46% of valuation is tech companies in the NASDAQ, 22% of them are companies who are tech. India, 13% of valuation is tech and only 9% are tech companies, right? But this is going to grow. So we're going to see these tech companies dominate in valuation like you have in the United States. But this is something that's happening in a beautiful way. At the bottom of the pyramid, 40% of people, and 40% of people could be 500 million people, that are all using mobile technology to connect to business. They're all using mobile technology to talk to each other. They're all using mobile technology to communicate to each other, see movies, etc. When Reliance Jio, a new player in telecom, said we're going to give free mobile to everybody, they found that consumption in terms of data was 45 GB per month. Wow. And 25-30% were all movies. Indians are great movie fans. We don't know what they see, we've got a faint idea, but they're all great movie fans. But you know, if you look at this slide, I might not be educated, but I know how to respond to queries I receive on the web. The internet and mobile technology will change in the next 3 years, the bottom 40%, and make them very productive. They're going to be completed. Prime Minister Modi has come with this plan for, plan for digital India. To me, digital India means a simple thing. 1.27 billion Indians are going to be connected to each other through a smart device with a low-cost data plan to the web. And once you come to the web, you get access to everything else. So e-governance is going to be through the web. Government delivers services. So you're not at the mercy of somebody who's an intermediary. You get education services. All children should have a tablet, so you get rich services. Before coming to India, I read an article which said that Pratham, some of you know Pratham, gave away 3,000 tablets to village children in some godforsaken place in Uttar Pradesh. And those children have never seen a mobile or a tablet. And they said within 10 days, they broke the code for their password and everything else, hacked into the system, and started doing wonderful things in terms of video, accessing knowledge, and writing many things, and programs and everything. And Pratham suddenly found a problem because the people whom they trained to train the children had to be retrained because the children are far ahead. And what do they show? If you give a tablet with rich multimedia content and Wi-Fi and 3G to children, they know what to do because the child is curious. Today in Bangalore, when a child is born, it comes with a tablet in his hand. And this tablet really helps because the children navigate, right? This comes very naturally. And Apple iPad is a fantastic thing. It's so intuitive. I never carried a laptop for 15 years as CFO of Infosys. But now I can't live without my iPad because it's so intuitive. I didn't want to enter the code on the laptop and all that. You know, it's too exhaustive. We have numbers in the head. Okay. So this internet change is going to come. So what will the future of startups look like? Startups in this country are going to be through an ecosystem, smartphone penetration, and what is called the India Stack. India Stack is a fantastic piece of technology work by volunteers led by Nandan. We have 1 billion people who have an identity in India. 600 million people didn't have an identity because they never had bank accounts, they didn't know what they are, they didn't have a postal address. They all lived in villages, and many of them, their thumbprints were gone because they're working on the land. So Nandan came with this Aadhaar, and in 6 years' time, we got 1 billion people. Now I think 1.1 billion people who got an identity of the largest database in the world. So with the database, just putting a thumbprint or iris or whatever it is, you can be authenticated. It's a fantastic piece of technology work, and this is going to change the way people communicate. And if you look at this data, there's something called the India Stack. The India Stack means a set of 5 things, that is Aadhaar for authentication, universal payment interface for making money payments on the mobile. Then there's a privacy layer to make sure that the data that you have is written by you and can give it to somebody only when you want. There's a digital locker and there is mobile banking. So all these India Stack inputs have been created by this group of volunteers free. So you can transfer money from mobile to mobile by just putting keying in a number. And this number, you don't have to know the bank account of anybody, but using the number you can do, it actually works. 27 banks have taken it up. In India, the banking sector is being opened up. We gave license to 21 banks in 3 months. In the last 45 years, only 14 new banks have come up. So we're going banking and financial services because we've got a large sector which is not into banking. So this is the new layer of technology that's coming up in the next 3 years. Next year we have a goods and service tax. That means the whole of India will be a common market. The whole of India is not a common market. Can you believe that? There are checkposts at various state borders, so lorries cannot go. You have to stay, pay a bribe to the guy, and then you're adjusted and you may go somewhere. And people cheat on taxes in many ways. So we're going to open up it up and make it a consumption-based tax. It's already come on. They're building a database management. 1 billion invoices are going to be on the system every month. And we're going to get credit for the taxes paid as input electronically so that you can always verify, there'll be an audit trail. There's a cashless layer, paperless layer, businessless layer, you know all this stuff. India is going from data poor to data rich. Social media, e-commerce, the payment mechanism, the paperless process, and digital identity are generating enormous amount of data. But all of you who work in the data, this is going to be the richest source of data in the world. 1.25 billion people doing transactions, and everything is going to be captured in some ways. You can find new patterns, you can find so many things, and this is going to be useful. You have to build application layers, mining tools, and all kind of stuff. So with machine intelligence and automation, we're going to see a rapid change driven by data. And this will increase market size by 10x to 50x in many industries, and the cost of doing business will be brought down. Because once you become productive, the cost will come down. China discovered an amazing thing. People's income may grow by 5% a year, but if you bring down the manufacturing cost, the price of goods, by 50%, the market expands 10x. And because of market expect 10x, you can buy huge quantities and the price comes down, and everybody can have a washing machine in the house, a car in the house, a house, and everything else. So income is not going to become a restraint for business expansion. So this is, we're going to have automated credit, so people can download data, get the credit score, and give money electronically to mobile commerce to the accounts of 600 million people who don't have access to credit with them in the formal economy. The new age platform, a digitizing ecosystem, so we're going to increase consumption of digital infrastructure, digitize supply chain. Like I said, Digital India means e-governance, education, it means e-health and all the nice thing, e-education, entertainment. We have 200 million artisans in India, 200 million artisans and people who work in the land. And these have been doing great stuff. If everybody gets a web page with a payment gateway, you can imagine what happens to them. When you buy something which is done by an artisan, artisan only gets 30% of the value of the sale. The middleman gets 70%. And the consumer has to pay 100%. If the artisan can get 50%, consumer pays 50%, it's a win-win for everybody, right? Just like Uber and like Airbnb is eliminating the middleman, you can do that with Digital India. And here you see the kind of companies that are there, and they're growing in e-commerce, in health, in food delivery, household services, hotels, others. These are all Indian entities which are developing. The jobs in India are going to be service providers into job providers. We're not going to see jobs in India by large companies. Well, they'll be there, but they're not going to provide jobs. But people, aggregators who come and connect people who can provide services to people who want them are going to be the differentiator. So, for example, you got service providers like Ola and Uber, which have got between them 1.5 million drivers with only 6,500 employees. But this is going to be the new age platform, which is going to accelerate and bring about a change in productivity. So you can see some of the examples here, what is going to happen with startups. Practo is in the medical area. We got Ola and Uber, and we got Paytm, which is connecting 100,000 merchants. They got 150 million people doing mobile wallets. I don't know whether you do mobile wallets in the US, probably are more sophisticated, but you know, they're able to transfer money. These are all funded by venture capitalists from China and America. And you find young people getting cash credits. So they're collecting money and getting many things free, and these companies are making huge losses. Hopefully they get more money to make more losses. So, this is one more slide about India stack. You know, IMPS, Immediate Payment Service India, bigger than Visa and MasterCard in terms of card transactions. Yeah, GST will see 3 billion. I stand corrected, 3 billion invoices a month. So this will be, India will be the largest e-sign, electronic signatures by 2016, and we're going to democratize innovation in the next 2 or 3 years. There's another slide. You know, India has got a million mutinies. Naipaul wrote about India as a country with a million mutinies. There are millions of people having mutiny to make sure they change. So hundreds of experiments, thousands of experiments all over the place. No barriers to entry are going to come because of technology. They're going to find innovation solutions, and these solutions are going to change. So the biggest experiment in social change, leveraging technology, is happening in India. And I wish all of you participate. So I want to end by saying that India is optimizing to empower problem solvers. Startups should be the force multipliers. You're going to make India productive and make India competitive. And many companies here, I know Carl has got a fantastic knowledge portal. You know, he's coming to India and hopefully making sure all young people get educated by giving them access. You know, Chamin is coming with U Plus and others. I know these two companies well. There are many other companies coming. So I would end by saying the action is in India, where you're going to see social change coming by technology. Come over, spend time, start your companies, do business in India. You're going to lose money in the first 5 years, so come with the fat first, because you're going to build networks and subsidize all these poor people till the income levels come up with your money, so they can become real consumers. And since all of you depend on eyeballs and you know, all the nice stuff, we show the J-curve. The J-curve will come from India. You know that WhatsApp is getting its thing from India, right? Right? You're going to get many, many subscribers. Facebook has got the largest number of users from India, 150 million. So anybody who wants to grow and show large consumers, come to India. The market is there. And together, we can change India and make it a $10 trillion economy by 2030. Thank you very much.
MR Rangaswami is a thinker, a technology leader, and the best connected person here in Silicon Valley. He's the head and founder of the Sandhill Group, more recently in Diaspora. And one of his big recent accomplishments was the Diwali stamp. How many of you have seen the Diwali stamp? That's thanks to MR. So, Mohandas is not shy to share his thoughts, and in MR we have a provocateur, so we'll have an exciting conversation for the second half of this event.
Thank you, Ravi. Mohandas, you've made some provocative, can everyone hear me?
Yes.
So you've made some provocative statements recently. You've said you don't want India to become a digital colony. You meant like a slave colony, I think, right? So what did you mean by that? I mean,
well, let me explain. We went through 200 years of colonization, all right? It happened because of one reason, what happened in America. Lord Cornwallis was defeated in the Battle of Yorktown by Washington. And because he defeated, he came to India. So that was the East India Company, and that led to colonization. So you're all responsible, okay? Now, what is happening in India? We're seeing these startups come up, but Indian capital is not investing in all of them. Capital from the United States is coming, and suddenly in the last 2 years, we see the influx of capital from China. China has got a huge surplus of capital, and they're all coming in. So many companies, large companies, that have grown up to billion valuation, are usually owned by American capital or Chinese capital.
Now you've got Japanese capital.
Huh?
SoftBank a little bit.
Yeah, SoftBank a little bit, but you know the Japanese are very different because you know they'll keep going down more and more. So you know they're very different. The Chinese are aggressive. The Americans know how to rule the world. So you've got Uber coming in, and Uber wants to dominate India. They got unlimited amount of capital. You've got Amazon coming in, and you know what Amazon does, right? Amazon can dominate. They got great tech. So Flipkart and Snapdeal are Indian companies competing, but they're owned by the Chinese. So if this happens, Indian capital doesn't invest. We have these two giants dominating India. Google dominates India. We don't have a version of Google like China does. Like Facebook dominates India. It's all Facebook. WhatsApp dominates India. And you know, eBay does some business in India, they got competition. But these are the giants that dominate India. Microsoft dominates India, right? But they're all, it's good to be dominated by an overseas power, but you also need some local competition. So what we fear is, you know, in the next 15 years, unless Indian capital comes up, we'll become a digital colony of somebody else. And the fear is like this. We've seen what happens when the NSA issues a subpoena to get data. If the data centers of all these companies are outside your country, your private data belongs somewhere. When Prime Minister Modi sends on Twitter, the data is here. If the data is here, the NSA can come and take the data and do what you want.
And it's sitting next to Mr. Trump's data.
Yeah, it's sitting next to Trump's data, but you know, it's here, right? So we're still getting some data centers here. Europe is solving the problem. So I made the statement to say that Indian capital should invest like in China, 65%. We have to be an open economy. Don't shut their doors like China did. But keep the level playing field. And that's what I meant. And we need some policy changes.
So your presentation was fantastic. You know, I was thinking of around the world in 80 days, right? We saw a tour of India in 2 hours. So that's pretty good. So please think of some questions. I have a few for Mohandas, but happy to take some more questions. The other area is at a macro level, right? So you've talked about the sharing economy and machine learning and AI and IoT and driverless cars and such. All these new technologies that we're investing here in Silicon Valley is going to disrupt and destroy millions of jobs in every economy, right? So looking at India, which is getting, I think, about 1 million new people coming into the workforce every month, so forth, how do you see reconciling these two issues of needing employment on one side, new technologies destroying employment on the other side?
Imran, I'm frankly very worried, and I'm getting more and more worried as the day goes by, because let's start with data. Like I said, we have 24 million young people attending the age of 21 every year coming for jobs. Are we 30% could possibly get married, work in agriculture somewhere, where there's, you know, otherwise. So we need jobs to the extent of possibly, let's say 1.5, 1.8, I mean 15 to 18 million. Okay, we're just producing 5.5-6 million jobs. So we got 10 million people who are not employed, are very underemployed. In the last 10 years, we got 100 million people, largely in middle India, who don't have jobs, underemployed, earning very much less. And the frustration in these young people is coming out in the form of agitations. We know the Gujar agitation, the Jat agitation, the Patel agitation in Gujarat, the Kham agitation. They're going to the street, they're burning buses, they want affirmative action, they want government jobs. Government can't give jobs. And the next 10 years, if it continues, another 10 million, another 100 million people will come. By 2025, we'll have 200 million young people in the age group of 21 to 45 who will have no jobs. And that is a generation that's supposed to pay the demographic dividend. I still talk about the demographic dividend because I don't want to lose hope. But it's a scary situation. And nobody knows where these jobs are going to come, because with all this automation happening, autonomous cars happening, Uber is not going to employ all of them. And with this AI, machine intelligence, jobs in banking is going to come down. For the last 15 years, banking sector in India has grown 10x in assets, 10x in liabilities, and 15x in profits, 5% in jobs. Only 5%. Of course, Infosys is also responsible, because 70% technology comes from Infosys in the form of core banking, but only 5% is scary. So I don't know, I'm very scared. And now with the innovation happening here, every time you come here, you see many things. You've got chatbots, you've got robotics, you've got, you know, then all this robo-finance, right? All the nice things. I don't know, Imran, I'm worried. I mean, I've been talking about it in the media, being a part of FICCI, which is a national business organization. We produce a research, future of jobs. And we give it to the government, they're still not written the report, I come to the last page. Hopefully they'll enter the last page, they'll be scared out of the way. So there's going to be social tension in India, there's going to be deep political challenges in India, and it's going to be all over the world. And we don't know. Now the basic income is a nice concept, Imran, but who's going to pay the basic income? If Trump reduces taxes for corporates 15% and personal tax down, where is he going to get the money to pay basic income? You know, even in America, you know, your social security system will be broke. Europe is already breaking, and India never had it break further. And now since we've seen TV and we got this mobile and we can see all those things, aspirations are high. So we can't even go back to the bullet car. Everybody wants a car. So Imran, my short answer is, he's very scared, I don't have an answer, and it's going to get worse.
So, hang on, I'll come to you in a minute. What follow-up question on that is, in the United States, every month, I think in the third week or whatever, Tuesday, there's a jobs report, right? And everybody here is fixated on job growth, right? In India, most of the workers are in the informal economy. So there's no jobs report that comes up. There's a GDP growth, like you said. But how does that
The government of India is oblivious to any job report or looking at data. They don't work on data. they just make statements because they've all been educated in the social sector and JNU. You know what is JNU, right? There's a challenge. They have a survey by the Labor Department that say India created only 135,000 jobs in one quarter. But we have a social security system where there are about 150 million accounts. See, every month if you're employed, you have to pay money into your Provident Fund account. If you've got income levels below, you've got something called employee state insurance. So you've got accounts. There are about 60 million people with those accounts. But government is not looking at the data. I'm working with Niti Aayog to produce a job labor report data, so you get authentic data. They got classification by 185 industries in all the states in India. Hopefully they'll come. So there is data, we've got to make it work. But the data will be still very distant. So hopefully we'll get it in the next 6 to 8 months.
Thanks. A question there?
Ravi Mistry here. Excellent presentation and dynamic one too. Can you shed some light on the healthcare data and healthcare economy?
It is this month. Our female mortality rate now is 140 per 100,000 births, which is very high. It's come down from 250 for 2 years. Our infant mortality up to 5 years is about 45 now. My state is about 34 or 35. And in terms of doctors, we have one doctor for 1,700 people. We need one doctor for 1,000 people. And we still have 30% of our population of children who are malnourished. Malnourished not largely because they lack food, but they lack good drinking water. And we did an experiment in a part of my state. If you have diarrhea 5 times a year, you are dead. There's nothing you can do, right? It's not a food problem. It's a clean water problem. And about maybe 40% of children are born underweight. Well, if you take correct data, adjusted for India, it could be 25-30%. But you know, the news is we are much better than 10 years ago, but we're still not there. And we lack health services in large parts of India. We've got very sophisticated tertiary health services cities. But in the villages, we don't have. About 85% of births are institutional births now. The 65% about 10 years back. In many states, the south is about 90-95%. So I think we're getting there in terms of everything, but we're still not there. We still got encephalitis, people getting dying because of that. Polio, but polio has been cured. We still got a little bit of malaria. Tropical diseases are still there. So it's a very strange country. The good parts, which is very good. There are parts which are living in the 18th century. So India lives the 18th century, 19th century, 20th century, 21st century, the same time. So the answer should be, come to Bangalore, very good, maybe 10 years behind the US, go to UP, rural areas, 2 centuries behind what is today.
So another question?
Yes.
I'm going to make a statement and then ask for your reaction. And just to give you the background, I'm a 35-year IBMer. I've been in IBM research, never been a manager, no people management, no money management. So pure techie. And for about 3 years, I was the IBM India chief scientist. My point is that in order for innovation to flourish in India, we need more people who stay technical for long periods of time. And as long as Indian society thinks that if you are a manager, only then you have made it in life, and people are judged based on how many people they manage or the budget they control, I don't think things are going to work out. In order for you to make decent contributions, not just research, even product development, whatever, you have to internalize the technologies, and for you to do that, even if you stay technical but you keep jumping from one topic to another, you cannot do deep work. What's your reaction?
I totally agree with you. I run HR in Infosys, and everybody's aspiration is to be a manager because you get paid more. We try to create the system to make sure that people who stay in the technical field, the extra 25-30% of the entire workforce, because you're in services, it's very difficult, are actually paid 15-20% more. Now I think the recognition has come, you need deep technology, the busy work is over, people are trying. It's a 5-10 year change. But we are seeing a different thing in startups. In startup, product development is, people are getting used to product development, the culture of, developing products, structuring products, the software architecture, etc. It's happening in a big way, but we have a long way to go.
Yeah, my point is also that I told Chris and various people, unless the top people make public statements about this is not going to work.
Exactly. But it's happening in the startup area, the much bigger way, the service.
But then you also need some areas where there's much more, you know, the IBM research kind of thing that you need also in addition to.
I agree. You know, these companies earn 25% net income on sales. They're swimming in cash. And now they're getting squeezed because of AI, automation, all that. So they learn they have to automate, create products, create frameworks, create all the technology. Now they're investing madly. But there is some hope. Because the market always makes sure that you are innovative to survive. Now it's happening.
So Mohandas, let me change to, you showed a lot of B2C companies and examples. Talk to us about the B2B market. Is there a local market in India that only exports to overseas?
Yeah. MR, you know, 10 years back, B2B companies were small, 3 million, 5 million. There are many, many companies, 50, 60 million. Okay? The total B2B is about, you know, I would say about 40 to 50% of the company startups are B2B, out of which 10% are showing signs. And in India, sadly, they're not able to sell at a decent price because technology absorption is less. So trying to work in India, trying to work in the United States, and some of them are doing well, like Freshdesk is trying to do something, they're trying to do well. So we see it coming up now. We're much better now than 10 years ago, and they're all coming to 50, 100 million rate, and maybe in 4 to 5 years, we'll see some of them doing IPOs and getting exits, and they reach $200 to $500 million, suddenly it'll be there. But the last 5 years has been B2C. Because B2C is easy, right? You sell something called gross market value, you discount it by 50% and still talk about gross market value. You get 30% returns and still talk about gross market value. And your market price is linked to gross market value. So it's a very different world. Now reality is coming in. So I think it's happening.
Another question?
Yeah, hi. Thanks a lot for those great comments. I have two questions. One is, do you see the role of government increasing as a result of trying to create a universal standardization where you can create that innovation and ecosystem platform, or leave it to the entrepreneurial community to kind of disrupt that? Second is, any updates on the smart city initiative? Because I know that's a big agenda on Prime Minister's office to create 100 smart cities. And then where do you really see what kind of technologies are actually being used to create that smart infrastructure? And the third part is...
I'll stop there and answer the question. I'll answer the question, but I need to understand. Look, we need a little bit more of government in India. Okay, we don't have a well-developed ecosystem. The government has to provide infrastructure, make the right kind of policies, protect consumers. Because we'll get monopolies if the government does not interfere. Some of them are government-run monopolies. Unlike the US, which went through the Antitrust Act and you broke up AT&T and broke up all these behemoths and opened up for a long period of time, it's taken 100 years here, or maybe more, to break up all these monopolies, right? We still have them, so we need government. Mm-hmm. But government is realizing they can't run business, they have to be enablers. So it's sinking in right now. Mm-hmm. Because the political establishment knows, if you invest in Air India and lose $1 billion a year, but you, instead of that, you go put give about 200 million people cell phones or whatever it is, then you can come back to power. But Air India is not going to get to power because people vote, the planes don't vote, right? They're going to lose money. So the real estate come, but we need government, but government is not stepping back from business. And as far as smart cities is concerned, we still have to evolve. For more cities, for about the 100 cities to be classified as smart cities, they're all putting up billboards and say, hey, we've been classified as smart cities. Then they say, what do we do next? Because they hired a consultant to make a report. They never read the report. So now they don't know what to do. And they have to be educated, right? And now we've got all these device manufacturers coming and saying smart city means you put sensors all over the place, and you put this intelligent traffic devices and all this. We are trying to talk to them to say, smart city means you have a city ERP to govern the entire infrastructure city has to do. You've got to have mobility solutions, you've got to have solutions for waste and energy, you've got to have solutions for sustainability, and you've got to have solutions for emergency services. It's a whole lot of things, but I think because you are smart, things are sinking in. In 3 to 4 years, there'll be a very clear definition, and I think something will happen.
Thank you.
A follow-up question on that, Mohandas. I know on the policy side, you're hosting, I think, an event in December. Can you tell us a little bit about how you're trying to get technologists and policymakers together? Because that's new for India.
Yeah, what we've done, Carnegie, Bob Burns had come to Bangalore with another gentleman, you know. And we met in Kiran Mazumdar's house and we suggested to him, when you talk about foreign policy, we've got to marry technology with foreign policy. Because technology is now leading foreign policy because the dominant part of the world business ecosystem. The most valuable companies in the world are tech companies and they are leading, right? So we told Carnegie, why don't you work together, set up a think tank in Bangalore, which will work on technology and foreign policy. So with Carnegie, some of us have come together, we're holding an event 6th, 7th of December, where we're going to talk about the impact of technology on society and the globe, and how we can use the technology companies to define what kind of policies, foreign policies government should have, for example, in regulation of the internet. For example, in opening up countries to overseas business in technology, for the movement of natural persons, and how do you create a new world order in handling terrorism and cyber threats, okay, in handling robotic warfare. Tomorrow, if robots are going to fight wars, and you're going to have drones in Nevada going and hitting Waziristan, how do we regulate that globally, right? Because what kind of controls are going to give a robot to fight a war? Should human beings be at the backside? We're going to discuss all this, and Bangalore and California, so we're going to have something in California and Bangalore, then go to Washington and Delhi. Because Washington doesn't get it. I'm sure you have the same point, right? Because they still have to deal with many other issues, and Delhi just doesn't get it. You know, we're alien to Delhi. Washington, of course, you got some lobby, so we want to create this think tank. That's a very interesting development. I hope all of you will participate in this.
Question? I think in the back.
Hi, my name is Satya. I work here at the SAP. When we talk about startup ecosystem, I think one of the key ingredients is the intellectual property protection. So from your viewpoint, where do you think the legal environment in India is to protect intellectual property, and what kind of reforms do you think is in place?
For IP, we are 80% there. Okay? There was a big issue in pharma. We had process patents rather than product patents. Now the law has become product patents like you do. In software, we are fighting a battle to prevent software patents for software because a very large issue, right? The problem is you get sued for nothing because somebody could have 10,000 patents and 95% of all patents in the world are defensive patents. It doesn't mean anything, but somebody could go up to you and say, you use this and do this, and one large company has come to India, they're going to all companies and taking money out of them because they said, we're going to sue you, blah, blah, blah. So we're going to say that in the area of innovation and software, having patent for software is something that you've got to think about very deeply. But I think as far as the courts are concerned, courts are now deciding in favor of the IP owners. And we got a robust new law in the last 5 years which protect IP, you know, IP of all innovators. But from the technology side, not many people are fighting patents because they think the life of a patent is very small. They still don't think like Americans, hopefully they will. But I think, but we're getting 80% there. I think it's much better than the media tells you what it is.
So question for you. You've asked a lot of people here to come and help India, participate in India. What are three or four opportunities that they can invest in? If you were investing today?
Look, first I'll talk about logic. First, come and mentor all those young Indian companies and give them support. Because you work in a very sophisticated economy, you know, you have mentors, capital, everything else, so come and mentor them and give them some insights, how to grow, what has to be done, all right? Second, connect them to people with capital. Even though America would dominate India, I'd rather be dominated by America than Russia, some other countries, no? But because, you know, we're all here. So I think help them connect. And third, help them connect with research centers and academia. Because it's very important for them to understand what is happening at the cutting edge. They're 5 years behind. If they come to 2 years being behind America, it'll be a fantastic opportunity. Now, as far as you are concerned, there are companies coming up in the area of applied AI and ML to solve many problems. That's a great area for investment. And second, there are companies in, image processing areas, which are again very interesting. The companies in B2B, which are making enterprise products, okay, in health and in education, in financial services, etc. For example, in financial services, the payment layer is getting disrupted in a very significant way, and I think that'll be interesting areas. So if you come there, many, many interesting areas. But the focus should be the Indian market 80% and 20% the US market.
Yes.
I had a question on the money demonetization, the recent kind of, what's the short term and longer term, you kind of positive?
Look, we have approximately about $250 billion in currency in circulation. 86% of that is 500,000 rupee notes. They've been demonetized, means no longer legal tender. Okay, so 87% would be something like $200 billion, or just for, okay? Out of $200 billion, about $80 billion has been deposited in the bank in 10 days. $80 billion. There's still $120 billion there. And we think about $35-40 billion is not going to come back. Okay? So we'll still see something like another $60-70 billion come back. And I'll tell you what happens. And we have two or three other problems. Pakistan has got a printing press from the same place where India bought the printing press. And they buy the same kind of paper. They've been printing notes and putting into Punjab and into Nepal to India and to Bangladesh coming to India. So we got maybe about $5 to $10 billion of fake currency floating around. There's a nominal value, but they've been sold at 50% discount because distribution costs are there, right? So that'll go away. And terror funding in India and in Kashmir has been happening. So in the last 10 days, there are those stone throwers in Srinagar. Everybody's quiet because they're getting paid money. Now they understood the money in the house that they built up has no value because all fake fake currency. So we're going to see terror funding. East of India, we got some communist problem, Maoist problem. They're also very quiet. And in my state, Pranav told me, he read a news report that 20 Maoists surrounded the government because they said, we got nothing to eat because we got no currency. So this is going to have very strange problems. The people with black money, unaccounted money are scared. They're trying to now find ways to do everything else. Ordinary people who had this money saved away are trying to change. They're scared. Business has come down 5-10%. Ordinary people, wages, I mean, employment has come down. Ordinary people are getting hurt. But you know, they all think things will be better. And we found two strange phenomena. Almost everybody in the country has got this 500,000 rupee notes, even the poorest of poor, because they've been stacking up. And next MR, women in all middle class households have got 500,000 rupee notes squirreled away. In fairly large numbers, $1,000, $2,000, $3,000. And Shipley is bringing out and telling everybody, what do you do with this money? So they've got to put it in the bank. So right now, things are coming up. In another 10-15 days, we'll get a clear picture. In December, I think it'll come well. Supplies of currency are coming in all over the place. So I think we'll muddle. Remember, India muddles through everything. Yes, sir. Yes,
sir. Hey, my name's Rohit. I was wondering, how do you think the effects of climate change will affect the Indian economy? And what can the Indian government or, you know, companies do in order to, you know, show people?
Good question. Let me give you some data. America is 6% of the world's population, consumes 25% of the world's energy. The problem is here. Okay? That's the first fact. We've got to be very cognizant of data. India has 16-17% of world energy, consumes 6%, but that's growing at about 78% a year. Okay? Not 78%, 50% of GDP growth, nominal GDP 8%, so 5% a year. Alright? So India has signed COP 21 in Paris, right? So what we plan to do is reduce the energy intensity of industry. But our per capita energy consumption is so little, we can't shove it down more. Alright, we need more energy. Okay? So we're going to replace 50% of coal-based plants in the next 10 years. We're going to replace them by better equipment, use combined cycle, which has got efficiency of 45%, as against these plants of 25%, and come to 660 megawatts plants. We want to use more gas, and we're tied up with America to supply gas. You know, your Henry Hub is $2.5 per billion British units. So you know, we're going to get cheap gas from America to India. That's a great thing because you opened up. So we're going to get much more gas. We're getting energy efficient equipment. About 20% of all lighting has been replaced by LED. It's a massive program, and that's come in. And Indian companies trying to be efficient. For example, Infosys reduced energy consumption from 295 units of power per person month to 165 in 6 years. The new campuses are at 90 units per person month. Fantastic technology, but Lawrence Livermore Lab is studying how to make it happen. And everything else. So many things happening, but energy intensity is coming down. And we're all scared that the water will rise 100 feet, and New York maybe 120 feet too. Mumbai will be down, Chennai will be down, Calcutta will be down. Bangalore is 1,000 meters, that's why I'm very confident of Bangalore.
And what about the pollution side, like in Delhi, you hear all these reports?
Yeah, we have some 1,200 something, whatever units of DPM pollution in Delhi, and they're unaware of it. They had a marathon at 450, okay? And all political leaders are going to cut their lifetime by 5 years, maybe good for us, but we want Modi to survive longer. Kejriwal, you know, it's okay. And we have a massive pollution problem. If you look at India, map of India, Delhi to Calcutta, there's a huge layer of smog holding above the landmass. And right now in the south, right from Mysore to Chennai, there's a huge layer, all right? So this summer, this winter, the layer came down. Because the winter temperature came down, the layer came down, and suddenly there's chaos. It's not due to the Diwali crackers. Delhi is 1,500 square kilometers, and if you use 1 kilometer height for 1,500 kilometers, the volume is so high, no amount of crackers bursting can ever pollute that atmosphere. It can be only minor, right? So it came down, and this is a problem. Now they're taking some measures. They're taking measures like getting in only electric buses there, shutting down power plants in Delhi, shutting down manufacturing plants. People are burning coal, they're giving them gas in the house to burn, and they're trying to divert traffic and many things else, but they just don't get it. I mean, I've been preaching and saying that young children below the age of 5 should be evacuated from Delhi. Because if you're under the age of 5, your lungs go, then you're gone for the rest of your life. It's terrible to bring up a child in Delhi. Bangalore is slightly better, it's come down because it's 1,000 meters up and then the breeze just comes in. I think it's a big problem. Just you had problem in LA 30 years ago, the same problem, we got to live for 10 more years.
Question there. Hi, I'm Satish, I work at SAP. You mentioned a couple of times that, you know, the investment in India is from the US, and that's great, and China. Why not in India? I mean, every time I go there, people are buying their second, third, fourth, fifth real estate plot or flat. Why can't they do it in technology?
The Indian capitalistic class is a rent-seeking class. In economics, rent means getting interest. They get interest by lending money at 12-15%. They're very happy with that because they don't want to take a risk except with the bank's money. Then they borrow the bank's money, invest and don't pay it back. Modi is studying the schools to get the money back. The rent-seeking attitudes are very different. They want to buy gold. You buy 1,000 tons of gold a year. We got 25,000 tons of gold in the country. $1 trillion. All right? Pliny the Elder wrote 2,000 years ago, trade with India will empower its Rome, because Rome imported spices and silk from India and gave India silver and gold. It's a very age-old problem because of insecurity. Okay? So I think we're seeing this kind of a challenge. So unless attitudes change, money will not come. And that's why we're all talking, getting public opinion to make sure, and telling them you'll get 4x, 5x, 10x. It's important for you to come and buy your companies and give us 100x exits and give us a little bit of money so that more Indian money will come.
Okay, time for one last question. I think back there. You can shout it out.
Okay, my name is Raju. I want your views on making India and what is the government doing for people who decided to make in India and are protecting them or incentivizing.
Well, there's a Make in India program to have Make India manufacturing base, and a mistaken notion that manufacturing will create jobs. So they're creating a set of incentives and things to make in India. They're inviting foreign players to come and invest in India and to say Make in India, make for the world. Okay? But you can't beat China, all right? And most manufacturing is automated. Some of the manufacturing outsourced to China is coming back to the United States and to Europe, except they're all going to be made by robots and by PhDs with physics, who are going to write these algorithms to make them, right? So even if you make in India, it's going to be automated. But they're trying to create a policy which encourages more manufacturing for local consumption, and hopefully that will create some kind of jobs. So it's exciting, but it's not going to solve India's problem. And there's no protection there for everybody to come in. We also have a large defense program to make, because we import $10 billion of armaments every year, the third largest in the world, I'm told, and they want Indian companies to make it. They didn't allow Indian companies to make it for the last 60 years because middlemen in Delhi will not get bribes. Because you make in India, you can't pay bribes, right? You import somewhere, you can get money in the Swiss bank account. So there have been scandals throughout, but now I think Modi is trying to do that. Hopefully this will improve. It's a step forward, very, very positive, but will it have the impact people think? That is doubtful. I'm being very honest with you, I hope you don't mind.
So I think, Mohandas, this has been a terrific session. Like I said, around India, 2 hours is fantastic. Nobody could get this. I think I like your advice on entering companies in India and doing our bit as Indian Americans to help out. And like you said, I think this crowd would love to participate in any kind of Bangalore, California, or Silicon Valley, Washington, New Delhi kind of a dialogue to kind of improve the whole thing. So I think there's lots of things you've left us with, but I really want to thank you for this engagement session.
Thank you, Imar, and I'm very grateful for all your invitation. No, the world is going to be ruled by the power of ideas. It's not money alone, it's ideas. Because ideas create value, ideas create. So I think we have a great opportunity to create a pool of people with ideas to make life better for everybody on this planet. And I think people in Bangalore and in tech and in Valley have a social conscience, right? We want to dominate the world through technology. We want to become billionaires, but we also want good for the world. I think all three can exist together. The rest of the world may have a problem with us, but I think we can work together. Thank you very much.